What is the spherocylindrical lens? To get the idea of that lens, the spherocylindrical one, you need to understand each one of them separately. We have the sphere lens when we cut the surface of the lens from a sphere shape or the ball shape. And we have the cylinder one when we cut the surface from a tube or the cylinder. So cylinder basically means tube and sphere means ball. Any point on the surface of the sphere has the same distance from the center of the sphere. So the radius of curvature here equals the radius of curvature here equals the radius of curvature here, which means the curve here equals the curve here equals the curve here, and so the power in this area equal to the power in this area equal to the power in the third area and equal to the power in each single surface at that sphere. If I draw the meridian x and y or 180 and 90 axis, the power here, let's say for example plus 2, will equal the power here and equal the power at each axis, 30, 45, 120, all of those have plus 2 power. And of course that works for both the concave lens and the convex lens. So for minus lens, let's say we have the power minus 5, it will be minus 5 here, it will be minus 5 here, at 10 degree also minus 5, 170 also minus 5. So the sphere lens had the same power at all meridians. But if we took a look at the cylinder one, you will see this area is curved like that, but the other meridian is flat, which means the curved area here has power because curvature immediately means power, but the flat area without power. If I flip or rotate that cylinder and change its orientation to be like this, for example, now the power will be in this direction because here we have the curvature and this axis or this meridian is flat. So we have power here and it's zero here. The zero lens, we call them plano, which means cylinder lens are kind of lenses that have a power at one plane only or at one axis only. That's our curved area and this is the flat area. This one consider as the axis meridian of the cylinder lens, and since we have the power in this area, let's say for example plus 3, this meridian we will call it the power meridian. So in cylinder lens we have axis meridian which contains the minimum amount of power. In our case here in the cylinder lens, it's zero. But in the power meridian, which is here, we have the maximum amount of power. Both axis and power meridians, we call them the principal meridians. This axis meridian, where the plane is flat and the power is zero, it cannot bend the light. But the curved area will bend the light. If we saw the sphere, any space at the surface of the sphere can bend the light in equal amount. So the sphere will collect the light at the same point. And that point we call it the focus point. But here in the cylinder, the axis cannot bend the light, but the perpendicular meridian can bend the light. So it will bend it like this, going along with the curvature. And the back area also will bend the light. So as you can see, it cannot collect the light at one point, but it will collect it at line. The coming light from different points all will collect at this line. So that the second properties of cylinder length. The first one, when we said we have power at one meridian only, and the other one is plano, and the second one, cylinder length focus light at line, not at point. So we will have focus line. Here we have the axis at 180 and the power perpendicular to 180, which is 90 degrees. But that power going along with the axis, going in this direction like that. So it's going with the axis direction. So the formed image line or the focus line will be like this. If we change the direction of that cylinder, so the axis will be 90 and the perpendicular power will be at 180, the power will go along with the axis. It will go along with 90 degrees. This time the formed line or the formed image will be like this. And since the light coming from front and from back like this, so if you saw it from above, it will be like that. That's the lens from above. The coming light will be like this. It will collect at this point, which means converge at this point and then diverge. So here the line will be wide, then narrower, narrower until it become a point here, and after that it start to become wider. So from above at beginning it's wide, then narrow, and after that it's wide. But from this side they all have the same height. Here it's wide, here it's narrower until it become this dot, and after the divergence again the narrow will become wider again. And since it's a long tube, the light here, if you put a screen in this area, the light will have this shape and then become narrower, and like that. For the sphere it's a full circle, so when you put a screen here the image will be like this, then smaller, then smaller. But in the cylinder the light, if you put a screen, will be elliptical like this. In the sphere we don't have to consider the axis since all meridians have the same power, but it's really important to consider it in cylinder lenses. As you can see here, the cylinder focuses the light at line while the sphere focuses it at point. See it from above, here is wide, here is narrow. If you put the screen in this area, for example, you will see the shape of light like this, a narrow one. But if you put it in this area, it will be a wide one. At this point is just a line to become wider again and even more. To the right here you will see the cylinder also have the negative lens, the concave one, and the positive lens, the convex one, and both they have the same lens formula. The power that depends on the focal length, the reciprocal of the focal length. So if you know the power easily you can find the focal length. If you know the focal length you can easily find the power. The sign convention here is negative for the focal length, and in the positive one the sign convention is positive. So basically like the sphere. But the most important difference that in sphere we don't have to write the axis or the meridian. We will just write +2, for example, diameter. That's all. The sphere length equal +2 diameter, or for example equal -5 diameter. That's all. But in cylinder we have to consider the axis. Let's say we have a cylinder length with curvature in the horizontal meridian, which means 180 at the power, since curved surface immediately means power. Let's say that cylinder or that horizontal meridian has the power +1 and the vertical meridian with infinity radius of curvature, infinity radius of curvature or infinity focal length, that immediately means the power is zero because the surface is flat. So here at 90, so here in 90 we have zero power or plano. This one we call it optical cross. So this is the axis and this is the power meridian. We can write it in cross form to say 1 power cross the axis 90 or perpendicular to the axis 90. Or we can use another form, we call it meridian form, to say plus 1 at this, so at 180. Mostly in clinic we use this cross formula, so we need to be careful in transcribing from a written description of the surface to optical cross. Let's have another example. We have minus 3 cross or axis 120. First of all, since the power is perpendicular to the axis, here the power, and this is the axis, one perpendicular to the other, we need to find the perpendicular axis to 120. If that axis is less than 90, we need to add it to 90 and we will find the perpendicular axis. If this axis bigger than 90 or more than 90, we will subtract the 90 to find the axis. So let's say we have 45. This one less than 90. So we will add it to 90 to find out the perpendicular axis, which is 135. Let's say we have 110. Since it's bigger or more than 90, we need to subtract 90 and we will find the perpendicular axis, which is 20. So here 120 minus 90, the perpendicular axis immediately is 30. Let's draw the optical cross to minimize the errors. This is our 90, this is 180, but our meridian is 120, which is here, 120, and the perpendicular one is 30, which is here. That's 30. So minus 3 is perpendicular to the axis or cross the axis 120, which means immediately 120 is our axis, so it's plano here, and the power meridian is the 30. Always when you see the cross or the axis, let's say 30, this one immediately is the axis meridian, which is plano. So here 30 is plano and the perpendicular one is the power meridian, let's say plus 3. 120 will be with plus 3. So after x, always the axis. After at, always the power meridian. So this one, if I want to write it in the meridian form, I will write minus 3 at the meridian 30. So this is the power meridian. And after x, minus 3 cross the axis, that's immediately the axis meridian. If we know the radius of curvature for that lens, we can find out the power by this power formula, where the power of the lens equals the refractive index of the lens minus the refractive index of the surrounding space divided by the radius of curvature. For example, we have a negligible lens. Negligible lens immediately means negligible lens had refractive index equal 1.5, and we place it in air. Air immediately, the refractive index of it is 1, and this lens has a positive radius curvature equal 50 cm in the horizontal meridian, which means immediately the power meridian is this one since it contains the curvature, and the vertical meridian radius curvature equal infinity. So that's the plan. Immediately, that's our plan. And here is our power in 180, and the axis is 90. How can we find the power of that lens? By using this formula, since we have the radius of curvature. Our radius of curvature by centimeter, but since we have power diopter, that immediately means we need to convert it into meter. So 50 centimeter equal 0.5 meter. So the power of that lens equal the refractive index of the lens 1.5 minus 1 divided by 0.5 meter. And after using the calculator, the result is plus 1 diopter, but it's cylinder. So our axis is 90. As we said, after x immediately we will put the axis. So we will write it like this, or you can write it 1 at 180. Here is our power meridian. So our optical cross will be like that, plus 1. What if we merge two cylinder lenses, or one cylinder lens with one spherical lens? This is the first cylinder, and the power in the curvature here, let's say for example it's plus 1 diopter. This is our axis, which means the curvature, which is perpendicular to the axis, at 90 degrees. That's the second cylinder, where is the axis, and the power in this curvature, let's say, plus 2. So it's perpendicular to the 90, which means the power meridian for this cylinder at 180. The total resulting length will be something like that. This is meridian 180 with plus 2 diopter, and this is 90 meridian with less curvature and power 1 diopter. What's the difference between this and the sphere lens? Sphere lens, the meridian here always equal to the meridian here. So both either plus 2 for example. But here in this elliptical lens, one meridian more curved than the other meridian. The meridians are not equal. And this is the sphere cylindrical lens. Which has the properties of both the cylinder and the sphere. It has power at all meridians such as the sphere, because as we said, cylinder has only at one power meridian, the other is plano, while the sphere has in all directions and in all meridians. So here in sphere cylindrical, we have power in all meridians, but at the cylinder lens, you need to consider the axis. In a spherocylinder lens, the power meridian contains the maximum power, which is here plus 2, and the axis meridian contains the minimum power, which is here plus 1. Okay, what if we add sphere to cylinder? So that's our sphere, let's say with power minus 5 diopter, and we add cylinder with power plus 2. Let's draw the optical cross to make it easier for you. This is the axis 180. The power will be perpendicular. So let's record it here. Plus 2 at 90. What about the sphere? Its power in all meridians are similar. So this is for the cylinder. Plus 2 at 90, which means 180 is plano. And the sphere has the same power at both meridians. So 180 and 90 both have minus 5 diameter. When we have a thin lens, sphere, cylinder, whatever, the total power of this lens, when we add the front surface power to the back surface power, so the total F will equal the power of the front surface plus the power of the back surface. Be careful, this is not the equivalent power. Equivalent is totally different. Equivalent we have it when we have two thin lenses and we need to consider the distance between them, and when we have one thick lens, and of course also we need to consider the thickness of that lens. So the total power is totally different from the equivalent power. This one works with the single thin lens. If we have plus 5 here and plus 1 here, the total power of that lens will be plus 6. If we have plus 5, for example, with minus 5, minus here, the total power will be plus 4. The same here will go with the spherocylindrical lens, since we will consider it as thin lens, but one surface is a sphere and the other surface is cylinder. So the power of this one, the cylinder, plus the power of the sphere will give us the power of the sphere cylinder, the total power. So since it's plano here, which is 0, plus minus 5, that means at 180 we have minus 5 diameter. At 90 degree, minus 5 plus 2, that's minus 3. So the power at 90 degree is minus 3 diameter. Okay, how can we write the spherocylindrical lens or the forms of the spherocylindrical lens? Let's take the same example. This optical cross, we can separate it into cylinders like that. Minus 3 at 90 degree, which means 180 will become plano, combined with 90 degree here is plano, and 180 with minus 5. So when we add this cylinder to this cylinder, it can give us this spherocylinder lens. So easily we can write it minus 3 diameter, axis the minimum power 180, combined with 5 axis 90. This form we call it the cross cylinder form. Or we can write it in the meridian form, which means minus 3 in the 90 or at 90 and minus 5 in 180, which means minus 5 at 180. So that's the second form of the spherocylindrical form. What about this optical cross You see, this one means on 180 we need minus 5, and in 90 we need minus 3. So I need to put a sphere length minus 5. So our length will be like that. Minus 5 here and minus 5 here. All the meridians equal minus 5. But in this meridian, I don't need minus 5. Minus 3 is more than enough for me. Which means I need to decrease this minus 5 2 diameters to become minus 3. So I will put that sphere, minus 5. And in front of it, I will put plus 2 cylinder to give me this result, minus 3. And of course, I will just put it here, which means the power here is plano, because I needed minus 5. And since the power in cylinder is perpendicular, it means I will put the axis of the cylinder here, because I need the power in this direction at 90 degrees. So our axis will be 180. The cylinder here is positive, so we will call this form plus cylinder form. So that's the third form. This is number 1, number 2, and this is number 3. Perhaps another one will come to say, no, I don't want to use minus 5. Instead, he will use minus 3 as sphere. So he will make it like this. He will put minus 3 as sphere. Let's draw it here. Put minus 3 as sphere, which means minus 3 here and in all directions. But in this area, minus 3 is not enough. We need minus 5. How can I make it minus 5? I will add minus 2, extra minus 2 to this axis to become minus 5. So here we will put minus 2 to become minus 5. And this time we need the power in this area only. Here is enough, so the power here is plano. So we will put our cylinder like that with this axis to have this power at this direction, which means it's perpendicular to 90. So our sphere here, and I will add minus 2 at the meridian 180, which means perpendicular to the axis 90. Here the form of cylinder is minus, and thus we will call it minus cylinder form. And this is the form number 4. So for this one sphere cylinder length, we can express it in 4 forms. Cross cylinder, meridian, plus or minus cylinder form. In clinic, we write it like this. The patient will come for us and his eye with astigmatism, which means he will focus one meridian in one area and the other perpendicular meridian he will focus it in different area. If I just put a sphere lens here, I will correct this one, so it will become here. But that means also this one will go back there, so I still have a problem. I need them both to focus on the retina. And this situation we call it astigmatism. To resolve this problem, both the horizontal and the vertical should focus on the retina by using cylindrical lens or spherocylindrical lens. So it will become like that. I put the sphere only here, so the horizontal will focus here. The vertical still need more power to focus here. So I will add more power to correct the vertical one only, since I already correct the horizontal one. So this extra lens or extra cylinder power will correct the horizontal. Now by the cylinder, the vertical one also located on the retina, and that's how we will correct the astigmatism patient. When we write the prescription, mostly it's a table. Of course, you will find right eye or left eye, and here you will find sphere, cylinder, and the axis. So if the patient has plus 1 diopter only or minus 1 only, we will write it in this area of prescription, and this is sphere lens. Sometimes other patient 0 here, which means he doesn't need sphere, he only needs cylinder. So it will become minus 1 for example, or plus 1, doesn't matter according to the patient. But in cylinder, you have to write the axis. So since it's just in the cylinder area, that's a simple cylinder, and we use it to correct simple astigmatism. Third patient need minus 1 sphere in addition to a cylinder lens. Again, we have to write the axis. So this is combination of sphere and cylinder, which means that patient need spherocylindrical lens. Let's have another example. So we have a thin lens with the following specification. The first surface is cylinder with minus 4, axis 120, and the second surface is a sphere plus 4 diopter. So what's the power of the lens? And let's draw an optical cross to specify the power of each surface. So those the meridian 90 and 180, and our axis here is 120. So 120 is plano. Perpendicular to 120 is 30. So at 30 meridian we have minus 4 diopter. When we add it to the sphere, the axis for the sphere and the power meridian have the same power. Here in the cylinder one, 30 is the power meridian. Here it is, the power meridian. And 120 is the axis meridian. Of course, in sphere, they have the same diameter. So the result, spherocylindrical lens will be plus 4 at 120. We will add it to the plano power, and that will give us plus 4 at axis 120. At meridian 30, plus 4 plus minus 4 will give us 0 power. So at 30, we will have plano power, and that the result spherocylindrical lens. As you can see, the power meridian now here in the spherocylindrical one is at 120, that's the power meridian, and the axis became 30. So note that the front surface axis is changed by 90 degrees in the total lens power. Adding a minus cylinder to plus sphere or the opposite. Plus cylinder, we add it to minus sphere with same power. For example, here minus 5 cylinder, we add it to plus 5 sphere, or plus 5 cylinder, we add it to minus 5 sphere. When we add those powers, the same power will change the minus cylinder into a plus cylinder, or the opposite, will change the plus cylinder into minus cylinder with the axis rotated by 90 degrees. As you can see, the cylinder here was minus 4. At the end, it become plus 4, and the axis here rotate by 90 degrees to become 30 degrees. Changing the form of the cylinder lens from minus to plus, or from plus to minus, we will call it the transposition. And how can we do that? Plus cylinder form to minus cylinder form, or the opposite. Let's have an example. So we have plus 5, that of course the sphere, with minus 2 cylinder axis 10. This is the negative cylinder form. We need to do the transposition to change it into the positive form. So easily, the first step to find out the sphere or the new sphere is to add the original sphere to the cylinder lens, which means plus 5, the sphere added to minus 2. The new sphere will be plus 3. And to find out the new cylinder, just change the sign of the cylinder. The old cylinder, if it's negative, it will become positive, and if it's positive, it will become negative. So here minus 2 will become plus 2, and that's our new cylinder, plus 2. And what about the new axis? That's the last step. The axis, just rotate by 90 degrees. So when we rotate 10, it will become 100, and that's our new axis. So here you change it from negative to positive forms. If you did the same three steps with this one, immediately you will have this result. If we have this object and we use cylinder with power in horizontal meridian, which means the axis will be 90 and the power is here in the horizontal, the light of course will bend like that to form line. So this area of the image, the vertical area here in the object, will be clear, but the other meridians will be blur. So the form image, when we have power in the horizontal meridian and the axis is vertical, will be like this. Only the vertical will be clear while the other are blur. And if I rotate this cylinder, which means the power will be in the vertical meridian, the focus line will be like this. So this time, this line will be clear in the image, which means when we have power in vertical meridian, the clear line will be the horizontal one. So if I put the cylinder like that, which means the power will be like this, and this is the focus line, that means this oblique meridian will be clear. So each point on the object forms a line image parallel to the axis, or perpendicular to the power meridian. So this is the axis, this is the power meridian. The clear image or the clear line will be parallel to the axis and perpendicular to the power meridian. When you put two cylinders together, Let's say the curvature here is plus 2, and the other cylinder with plus 1. So this is plus 1 at 90, here 90, and 180 with plus 2. Here it is 180. Let's say that's our spherocylindrical lens. Here we will have 2 more curved, and this is 1 less curved. Since plus 2 more powerful than plus 1, it will bend the light faster, so its focal length will be shorter than the focal length of plus 1. And since it's a cylinder, it will focus the light in line. As we said here, the line will be parallel to the axis, so it will be like that. Here it is our vertical line. If we put a screen here, the shape of light will be like this. If we put it here, the light will be thinner like this. Until we reach the focal line, the light will be as line. Then the light will start to diverge again, so it will become wider again and wider and wider. That's for plus 2. How can we find the focal length? The same way of the sphere lens. And since the power of the lens is 2 diopter, the focal length will be half meter. What about plus 1 diopter? The focal length will be farther, 1 over 1. The focal length is 1 meter, and the line will be horizontal, like this. That's a horizontal one. It should be 180, but let's assume it's 180 here. So if we put a screen here, the shape of light will be like that. Then thinner here, thinner, until at the focal line, this area, it will be just line. At some point, precisely this area, those two light will interfere to form a circle. And this circle, we will call it circle of least confusion. And the distance between the two line images, the horizontal and the vertical, we call it interval of Stern. This circle of least confusion would be the spot where the best image is obtained in a least area. So how can I locate the position of this circle? Well, by using the divergence formula. Divergence, when we have the lens, a sphere one for example, and we have this focal point, the first one and the second one. This triangle area is the divergence. And the amount of this triangle, or the amount of the divergence, we measure it by diopters, and all the time the diopter is reciprocal to the distance. So when I need to find this incident divergence, let's say U, the divergence of incident will equal the refractive index of the surrounding medium, which mostly is air, so it's mostly 1, divided by the distance here, which is the distance between the lens and the object. So the incident divergence will equal 1, or the refractive index of surrounding area, divided by the distance between the lens and the object, U. And to find out the divergence in this area, we will relate it to the distance between the lens and the formed image. So the divergence of emergent will equal the refractive index of surrounded area or surrounded space divided by the distance between the lens and the image. Also, the vergence or the amount of vergence in this area depend on the distance between the object and the lens, and also depends on the power of the lens. So we can see the emergent vergence equal the power of the lens plus the incident vergence. This one. Those formula we can use them to locate the image in spherocylindrical lens, and we can also use it in sphere lenses. But in sphere lenses, mostly we depend on power of the lens equal 1 over f, or 1 over f equal 1 over the distance between the lens and the image plus 1 over the distance between the object and the lens. So how can we use those vergence formula to find the location of the circle of least confusion? The location of the circle may be calculated by averaging the vergence emerging from the lens. So the average emerging vergence equal the emergent vergence from the first principal meridian plus the emergent vergence of the second or the other principal meridian. And since we need the average, we will divide it by 2. And the reciprocal of this one yields the location of the circle of least confusion. So we will have this formula: 1 over the average emerging vergence, the reciprocal of it will equal the location or the distance from the lens to the circle. So this one is the reciprocal of this one, which means this distance also will equal 2 over V1 plus V2. V1 is the emergent vergence of the principal meridian, and V2 the emergent vergence of the other principal meridian. And when parallel rays are incident upon the lens, the average vergence leaving the lens is the average power of the lens. So the power of that lens, or the average power, the average here, or we also we can say the total power, will equal the power of the first principal meridian, or in the first principal meridian, plus the power in the second principal meridian divided by 2. If we have the lens in plus or minus cylinder form, that total power or the average power will be the power of the sphere plus the power of the cylinder, but this time only the power of the cylinder divided by 2. So as you can see, a lot of formula just to locate the location of the circle. And that's why in sphere lenses we don't depend on vergence to find out what we need, but we depend on those simple formula. Let's have an example so you can understand it better. If we have object placed 1 meter in front of spherocylindrical lens plus 8 plus 2 cylinder axis 180. How can we calculate the location of the circle of least confusion for this object? So this is the distance between the spherocylindrical lens and the object, which means this is the distance of the object, or we can call it u. And we also know the power of the lens. So we can imagine it as sphere lens with cylinder lens, or we can imagine it as two cylinder lens. So the first cylinder lens plus 8 at axis 180, which means 90 is plano, and we will add it to the other cylinder to have this spherocylindrical lens. So we will do the opposite steps that we did here. This time we will change it from this form to this form, to the optical cross. That's back to our example.
So easily we will add this one to this one and we will know the other cylinder length plus 10 diameter. Add this our meridian and the other axis will be planum. The result will be this optical cross for spherocylindrical lens. So let me explain it for you quickly. We have sphere with plus 8. In this area, plus 8 is not enough. We need plus 10. So we need to add plus 2 above this area at this meridian so we can have plus 10. So this is our plus 2. So our incident divergence, which is u, will equal 1 over the distance between the lens on the object. 1 because mostly we will look at in the air. This is the refractive index of the surrounded area. And our distance here, as we said, 1 meter. So it's 1. And we have to pay attention to the sign convention. The distance between the lens and the object, and it's to the left of the lens, that's immediately negative. So 1 over minus 1, the incident divergence equal minus 1 diopter. So the emergent divergence will equal the power of the lens, and here we will select the meridian power as the maximum power in the spherocylindrical lens. So here it's plus 10. Plus 10 plus minus 1. Because as we said, divergence of emergent will equal the power of the lens plus the divergence of incident. And here in our example, it's minus 1. So our V equal plus 9 diameter. And the location or the distance between the image and the lens will be the reciprocal of this one. V equal 1 over emergent divergence. This is the image distance. And 1 over 9 diameter will equal 0.1111 meter, which is 11.11 centimeter. Okay, now we need the divergence of emergence for the second meridian. For the first meridian it was 9, and now we need it for the axis. So divergence of the axis this time will equal the power at the axis, which is plus 8 plus minus 1. Perhaps you wonder why we still have minus 1, which is u, the distance of the object from the lens, and why we have two divergences. Well, let's draw it. That's our spherocylindrical, and here is our object. So the divergence here from the lens to the object, just 1, but here we will have two lines, the horizontal one and the vertical one. So that's why we have two divergences of image and only one divergence of incident. So the result here will be plus 7. And the distance for the second line will be 1 over 7 diameter. That's equal plus 0.1428 meter, which means 14.24 centimeter. So the location of the circle of least confusion, the average location, will equal 2 divided by the divergence of emergence for the ferrous plane or ferrous meridian and the divergence of emergence for the second meridian. This is 2 above 9 diameter plus 7 diameter. This will equal plus 0.125 meter, which means plus 12.5 centimeter. So for this lens, the spherocylindrical lens, the first line will locate at 11.11 centimeter, and the second one will be at 14.24 centimeters, and the circle of confusion will be somewhere between them, which is 12.5 centimeters. Sometimes the distance could be negative, which means the formed image will be from this side of the lens, and that immediately virtual image. From this side to the right side, it's real, and from the left side, the object side, the image will be virtual. So you see, the formed image could be virtual, could be real, as in the sphere lens. Since we have two meridians here, normally the formed image both could be real, both could be virtual, and even one real and the other virtual, and the circle of confusion in somewhere between those images. What if I need to find the average power? We said the average power equal the power of the first meridian and the power of the second meridian divided by 2. In our example, the first one is plus 10 plus 8 divided by 2, means the average power for that spherocylindrical lens equal plus 9 diameter. What if I use the cylinder form? The average power will equal the power of the sphere plus the power of the cylinder divided by 2. So here our sphere, so if we use the cylinder form with positive 1, the sphere is plus 8 and the cylinder plus 2. So plus 8 plus 2 divided by 2. This will give us plus 9 diameter. So the same one here, it will not change since it's for the same spherocylindrical lens. Perhaps you want to use the minus cylinder form. So how can we make this as minus form? As we said, add the sphere to the cylinder, so plus 10. Change the sign of the cylinder, so minus 2, and rotate the axis by 90 degrees, which means the axis will be 90. So the sphere here is 10, the cylinder is minus 2, plus 10, plus minus 2 divided by 2, and the result also will be plus 9. So whatever form you want to use, you will have the same result since it's for the same spherocylindrical lens.
What if we have obliquely crossed cylinder? That means when you put two cylinders, but not perpendicular to each other. For example, this one with axis 40, normally the other cylinder should be at axis 135, but instead you put it at axis 170, so they are not perpendicular. So if you have one meridian, you cannot know the other meridian since they are not perpendicular. There are two procedures for calculating the combination of obliquely crossed cylinder. One is graphical and the other involves mathematical calculation. Or easily, the simplest way to determine the resultant spherocylindrical is to place the lens in a lensometer and read the powers and the axis directly.